Recorded Books presents a sci-fi audio production, Chill by Elizabeth Baer. This unabridged recording is narrated by Alma Cuervo. Sci-fi audio is an imprint dedicated exclusively to science fiction and fantasy titles on CD, from classics to bestsellers, cult hits to critically acclaimed award winners. And now, Chill.
From Henry IV, Part 1, by William Shakespeare. Glendower, I can call spirits from the vasty deep. Hotspur, why so can I, or so can any man. But will they come when you do call for them? Chapter 1, Halfway to Standing. From Letter to a Young Activist During Troubled Times, by Clarissa Pinkola Estes, Ph.D. When a great ship is in harbor and moored, it is safe, there can be no doubt. But that is not what great ships are built for. The first hint of returning consciousness was the icy tickle of fluid dropping across his lids, lashes, nostrils. Pain followed. The tidal roll of hurt through his body, too severe for his symbiont to heal or silence. Tristan Kahn opened his eyes within his acceleration tank. As the hyperbaric fluid drained from around his chest, his diaphragm spasmed. Shattered ribs ground in his flesh. The tank spilled him on the slotted deck, festooned like a newborn with blood-stringed goo. He pushed against the deck, but pulped arms could not lift his face from the puddle of oxygenated fluid. He heaved. Slime roped from his nose and mouth, tinged blue with blood, bringing with it bright pieces of tooth and lung. He could not raise his head. He thought, then there were none, and wished he could give himself up for dying. But here he was. And if he was hurt, he was living. Beside his shattered cheek, cobalt tendrils groped across the deck, met and merged like pooling mercury, then sent questing distributaries crawling out until they found Tristan's skin. As his symbiont repatriated its estranged fringes, pain increased. Crushed bones shifted in rent meat, his body and its symbiont struggling to heal. He might have whimpered, but the whistle of compressed breath was his loudest sound. As the fluid dripped between his shoulders and down his neck, he lay slumped, staring along the seemingly infinite curve of acceleration pods lining the hold. The weight of all that empty space pressed him to the deck as surely as did the world's artificial gravity. In this position, Tristan had time to think. One of the things he thought was, isn't it peculiar that mine is the only opened tank? He lay there until the fluid on his body had dried to yellowish crusts and cold air raised his skin in plucked bumps. The grinding of bone fragments lessened as his symbiont forced his skeleton into shape. Once the bones began to knit, torn flesh and bruised organs healing, the symbiont had sufficient capacity for managing his pain. He got a full breath without screaming, felt his ribs expand and his diaphragm flex, and pressed a palm flat to the corrugated decking. The hand expanded as his weight bore down. Within the envelope of his skin, flesh and bone held. He straightened the elbow, lifted the shoulder, dragged the second numb arm out from under his body, braced it as well, pushed, locked out both elbows, and let his head hang. On your knees was halfway to standing. Tristan gritted half-rebuilt teeth and finished the job. For seconds, it was all he could do to remain upright. He hadn't even the strength to put out a hand and steady himself on the skinned, gray-membraned interior of the open tank door. But if he fell, he did not know how long it would be before he rose again, if he had the courage to try it at all. Sticky feet slurping the deck, Tristan turned and walked a step. Now he stroked fingertips slightly along the surface of the pods, finding his balance. Deep breaths, slow until he could no longer taste the blood on each, pushed oxygen into his blood. At least the atmosphere was holding. Examining the warped bulge of the sky, he amended, at least here the atmosphere was holding. Staring up at the sky helped keep his eyes off the horizon. It took 10 dragging steps and 47 seconds to shuffle to the readout panel of the acceleration tank, two places to the left. This tank remained sealed. Condensation brushed from the readout revealed as many orange and yellow status lights as blue, but even when he squinted to focus blurring vision, there were no red ones. That was relief. That fresh upwelling that stung his eyes and tightened his chest, though it took moments before Tristan could parse the sensation as emotion rather than pain. Percival was alive. He leaned heavily on the mint-green exterior of her tank, and for the next few moments concentrated on controlled breathing. Strength was slowly returning, but he would need resources, protein, calcium, fluids and collagen and amino acids, all substances his symbiont was depleting as it repaired his wounds. When the hold stopped spinning in his vision, he lifted his head. "Hello?" It echoed. Layered, complex echoes that would have told him a great deal about the shape of the hold if he hadn't known it already, and the number and arrangement of the tanks. The heavy echo of fluid rang back from every side. Other than the one he had emerged from, each nearby acceleration tank was full. He wondered how many of the world's scattered survivors had trusted the voice of the angel when it declared emergency, and how many of those had managed to find an undamaged tank before it was too late. "Khan." He tried to find a voice of command. "Khan, can you hear me?" "Prince Tristan." The bodiless voice was a stranger's, but it carried inflections familiar enough to layer new aches and sorrow over already complex emotions. It was the voice of Percival's new angel, and he could imagine he heard Rien's phrasing in its words. "I hear you," said Tristan Khan. "What is your name?" A pause followed, which would not be the angel pausing. When the answer came back, it was with the echo of Percival's voice, the muddy qualities of sub-vocalized speech. "I have not been named." "We're underway," Tristan said, watching egg-blue bruises recede beneath the translucent skin of his arms. "Is the ram scoop functioning?" "Yes," said the angel. "A shimmer in the air, and it—" He, Tristan guessed, though he must admit to himself that he was guessing, faded into visibility. The material of its construction masked only grams, but that lacework was enough to make a solid-seeming avatar. The angel's form was androgynous, rangy rather than slender. The sleeves of its black blouse hung from spiky shoulders straight to band cuffs vined with tiny silver and fuchsia flowers. A medium brown complexion blended into cropped dark hair. It said, "We are maintaining velocity at approximately 30% of C." "Structural integrity?" A long time ago, he would have asked first after personnel, but with maturity had come the understanding that there was no life without the machine. "The world is approximately 43% intact," the angel said. "However, portions of the superstructure remain beyond my reach. I am blind and numb there. Before the supernova, based on incomplete available data, integrity was at 64.3%. Finally, Tristan allowed himself to ask, "Casualties?" He imagined the turning webwork of the world blasting through the enemy, trailing irreplaceable materials and infinitely replaceable lives. The symbiont could reclaim lost bits of Tristan's blood and body, but whatever fell to the enemy was gone. The world had shrunk while he slept. "By extrapolation, I estimate 16%, the angel said. My communication and proprioception protocols are damaged. Contact with outlying sectors is tenuous. Life support is suboptimal in all sectors with which I do still have contact. The world has sustained intense radiation exposure and shock damage. We've lost a great deal of atmosphere. I am synthesizing carbon and oxygen from available and reclaimed materials and attempting to preserve biodiversity, but it will be some time before we are ready for more than a skeleton crew. Which leads me to the reason I have awakened you prematurely, Prince Tristan. I'm sorry, but I needed your help." It was a completely unangelic thing to say, and it broke Tristan's heart along a fault line he hadn't known existed. The angel's impulse to speak that way hadn't come from Samael or Azrafil or dust, but from another consciousness subsumed in the machine. He turned the thought away. "You do yourself no kindness when you play that game, Prince Tristan." He said, "How can I help you?" "My captain," said the angel, "I fear for her courage and the resolve of her heart, and she will speak to no other but you. She says you are to be her first mate, and I am to follow your commands and leave her in peace with her grief." Tristan leaned against her tank, the medical green upholstery sticky against the skin of his back. He let his hand splay against the surface of the pod as if he could touch his niece reassuringly through all the polymer and fluid that separated them. He knew that peace intimately and of old. For all her courage and determination, Percival was very, very young. He said, "All right. Is life support in engine functional?" "The domain of engine is closer to intact than much of the rest of the world, sir." "The first thing we must do is repair the bridge. Start awakening such of the engineers as will survive the process." "Yes, sir," the angel said. Tristan held up a hand. "Caitlin Kahn first," he interrupted. "And please draw me up some schematics of the world as she now sails." "As I now have contact with her, sir, it's the best I can do for the moment." The bridge was not a shambles. Given its state the last time Tristan had seen it, he could only assume that its repair had ranked high in the angel's priorities even before he had given his orders. Fixing the bridge would be a service to the angel's captain, which was in turn a service to the world itself. The three things, angel, captain, and vessel, were inextricable in the mythology of both engine and rule, and inextricable in reality as well. Tristan paused just within the door, remembering this space as he had seen it last, cobwebbed, crumbling, torn open to the enemy. Now he walked over rolling clover speckled with blue and purple wildflowers, bluets, nightshade. In the shadow of chairs and control panels, the scarlet trillium petals of wake robin hugged the soil, the coyness of their form, a contradiction of their color. And overhead, and on every side, the stars. It could not be a direct window, Tristan knew, nor even an unedited view, because the Jacob's ladder still sped along in concert with an expanding debris field from the death of the shipwrecked stars. Their explosion had given the world acceleration. Now, as electromagnetic nets were reconfigured to sweep shattered star stuff into the world's needy maws, their corpses fed its reawakening engines. Instead, Tristan saw the stars as they would have looked without that radiant layer of dust and gas. A spectacular interstellar night, unbesmirched by the newborn nebula. As the Jacob's ladder accelerated, it would leave the blast front behind, but for now, they traveled in company. The filtered stars seemed stationary. At these distances and speeds, the apparent motion was negligible. While Tristan paused to take in the panorama, the angel again faded into existence before him. The avatar moved from panel to panel, exactly as if it needed to touch the controls to affect them. Tristan supposed the builders had been more comfortable with a visible, benevolent presence, but he found it redundant. "Please bring up a set of status panels for me," Tristan said, shipwide. "As much of it as I have," the angel corrected. "With emphasis on engineering, casualty and damage reports, medical reports on surviving crew, material attrition reports, key personnel, and a list of any missing or dead." Rien, of course. He wondered if the angel would include her among the lost. She wasn't, exactly. And even if she was, her death, which wasn't actually a death, although it was a cessation of independent existence, had preceded the supernova. Whether or not the list spared her name, Tristan knew it would be replete with others equally dear. The air before him darkened, though it did not lose transparency. Bright columns of words and numbers scrolled through it, too fast for a mean to read. They did not strain Tristan's ability. The angel asked, "Among key personnel, are there any in particular whose status you would like ascertained? There's a great deal of damage, so if I can focus my inquiries." "Caitlin," he said. "Benedict. Any members of the Khan family or the senior staff of Engine or Rule." Then, gritting his teeth, he said the name he least wished to. "And Arianehrod." His granddaughter had engaged in murder, treason, and biological warfare. She and her daughter, Ariane, had unleashed a deadly engineered influenza in Rule and allied with the rogue AI Azrafil to attempt to usurp control of the world. It was their actions that had led to the unmaking of Arianehrod's other daughter, Rien, a child Tristan had held quietly dear. It would be provident if she had died in the Nova. But in Tristan's experience, providence so rarely lived up to its name. "The tanks of the individuals indicated by name are intact," the angel said immediately. "Prince Benedict has already been released. So has the chief engineer. I am processing the remainder of your request." "Thank you," Tristan said. Benedict Khan had suffered worse awakenings, but only one or two. Now he pushed himself out of the still, damp capsule, rubbing slime from his lashes and felt the unmistakable heat of repair along the length of every bone. "Burn this," he said, stumbling against the wall of a neighboring pod. It caught his shoulder and kept him upright, but he found himself clinging with his fingertips to a cargo net nonetheless. His clothes and tools were bundled into the net on his own pod. If anything was still usable, he'd want it. The cloth should have survived. "How bad?" "Bad," said the angel who had awakened him. "Prince Tristan is acting as first mate on the orders of Captain Percival." "Percival is not well?" Benedict pulled himself upright. He turned and found the webbing containing his gear. Fingers numb as greasy sausages, he pawed at the ties, but his hands shook too hard for usefulness. "Percival is still healing and sick with grief," the angel answered, with a compassionate dip in tone that Benedict swore he knew. He felt it like a dagger, the pain as sharp as if the edges scraped bone. But she is the captain. She will do what she must. Rien, Benedict said, once, to hear himself say it. The angel gave him a moment of silence. Then, regretfully, he answered, I am sorry, Prince Benedict, but I am not Rien, nor can I be for you. There is too much else within me. Benedict shook his head, too overcome to speak plainly. He knew, and that wasn't what he'd meant. She was gone, and he'd barely met her. It would be easy to blame her mother, but the truth was, he'd cheated both of them. There had been better ways if he'd troubled himself to find them. So now, though Rien deserved more, in her memory he gave himself an instant to waver with the pain. Then he closed his eyes and imagined himself turning and walking away. Benedict kept an ice-walled place in his center, and he knew it well. Now he imagined himself in the long corridor leading down, the heavy door swinging open to his touch. He imagined the chill, stale air across his face and hands. He imagined that he stepped within. The walls were perfectly clear, perfectly frozen. He could see out with clarity, but no pain could reach through the ice. After his sister Kinrick's failed revolt against their father, the Commodore, Benedict had become her executioner. He had not been terribly young by mean standards, but he had been a very young exalt. He'd first built this fortress to endure that day, and in the centuries since, he'd retreated here more times than he cared to think on when war or necessity left no room for mourning. He'd used it when Percival's mother, Caitlin, left him for allowing his other daughter to be fostered in rule, and he told himself there was no shame in needing it now. He swung the imagined door closed with a touch and felt it seal. Lock out the hurt, he willed it, as he had willed it when he had lost Caitlin, as he had willed it when Kinrick's blood had writhed and then clotted in the crevices of his hands. The mean had called his sister Kinrick the Sorceress and held her in a kind of concerned awe. But her sorcery hadn't saved her in the end. Percival would have to learn this too, if she were going to command. He would teach her if she'd let him. He clenched his hands, drove the nails into his palms, felt the blur of heat, and soothed it away. Ice. It was all ice. War meant loss. He should be able to treat the loss of his daughters as he would treat the loss of anyone's child. Every baby was worth the same to a general. He would be a father later, he promised himself. Soon, before it became too easy to let the ice seal that pain away forever. He would do better this time. As he thought this, he thought he even meant it. But he had a hard time believing himself anyway. When he opened his eyes and spoke again, his voice was smooth and cool. What does Tristan require? Proceed to central engineering, the angel said. I must awaken the chief engineer. Benedict pulled his trousers from the net bag and began to struggle into them, all the while suspecting that there was no way he could make the ice quite thick enough. Chapter 2 On Fragile Bone From Leviathan by Thomas Hobbes. The fool hath said in his heart, there is no such thing as justice, and sometimes also with his tongue. At the rim of the world, a blind white hawk with a serpent's tail stretched his wings to the utmost and batted furiously on the edge of an acceleration-shattered cliff. All around, furrowed earth lay strewn with splintered branches. Gavin did not need sight to observe that the wood had cracked and spiked in spirals along the grain, showing how it had broken green. The air still reeked of sap and crushed fruit rotting, upturned earth, the fermenting remains of misfortunate worms. He flapped again, beating hard to lift himself from the cliff in this thin atmosphere and elevated gravity. The world had sealed its pores, so precious air no longer fed the enemy, but it would take time to replace what had been lost. Altitude did not improve the prospect. The wood, which had also once been a library, lay in ruins. At least the librarian, who had sheltered in an emergency pod, was still alive, and that meant the trees could be replanted so their fruits, full of ancient lore, could thrive again. Gavin broadened his wings and thinned the mass of his body to a latticework, increasing his glide ratio. Now he got aloft. He turned into the current, borrowing its lift, and began quartering the devastated hold. The strokes of his wings bore him over a forest of blasted trunks, some trees shattered to the root, some still standing, but with the bark rent in deep vertical lines. He thought maybe 50% could be salvaged, and those only because their sap swarmed with symbionts. The rest were fodder for the disassemblers. Before long, he sensed motion. A figure crouched in the midst of the heaped, horrible slurry. Gavin spiraled closer, banking, and made sure to flap his wings hard enough to be heard. The figure raised a clenched hand without looking up to check the source of the sound. The basilisk struck Mallory's fist with talons outreached, careful not to break the skin as he backwinged and settled. Mallory's arm dipped under the weight, but the necromancer was braced and bore it well. Gavin hopped from fist to shoulder, condensing, and slipped his tail beneath dark brown curls to encircle Mallory's warm neck. "This is a setback," Mallory said, raising a hand with which to settle Gavin's ruffled feathers. Gavin rubbed face against cheek, tilting his head so the razor-edged beak would not brush soft skin. "Are all the trees destroyed?" "Yes." Mallory opened the hand Gavin had settled on, which had been resting against Gavin's wing, and lowered it. The fingers were muddy as if from rooting in the earth. In the palm lay the pulp-smeared stone of a fruit. "I need them all. Cuttings, too. We'll have to clone for rootstock, but once the trees are forced, we can begin grafting." "It shall be as you instruct," Gavin said. He hopped down from Mallory's shoulder and, spreading himself into a fine wire mesh, began the laborious and delicate process of reclaiming as much of the world's remaining library as possible. While he worked, he asked, "And when the library is reseeded, what then?" It would take time to grow to fruition, but there would be other tasks in the interim. Mallory seemed about to answer, but some distraction prevented it. The necromancer said, "We'll have to see when it's done. Fetch my pack, Gavin. It appears this replanting must be left to the automata." Gavin craned a long neck over his shoulder, sweeping the focus of his senses across Mallory. "Someone has contacted you." Mallory nodded. "We are, it seems, available. The chief engineer sends word. We are for rule, in haste." Gavin, the servant, made no argument. As he spread his wings, he asked, "Is it this bad everywhere?" Mallory hesitated and, after a long pause, said, "There will be a great deal of work for necromancers." Caitlin Kahn stood before an acceleration pod, watching condensation freeze upon its surface, and contemplated murder. Her powered armor exoskeleton was all that propped her battered body upright, though she had not yet adjusted to the armor's silence and lack of personality. She missed the demon that had dwelled there while the world had been becalmed. Many years of working with it had taught her to consider it a friend. But like its brothers, it was gone now, silenced and consumed. The particular pod she contemplated was intact, more the pity. Several farther down the row had not survived acceleration so well, hanging ruptured and askew. The bodies inside were either being repaired by their symbionts to take their places among the mute resurrected, or they were being disassembled for components. Later, Caitlin would check which was true. The tank she stood before was opaque, and in a true analysis, nothing required her to attend in person. She could have consulted her imaging systems from engineering, if all she wanted was to observe the feed of Arianrod restrained in salty, incompressible fluid. The image floated before Caitlin's inner eye now. Arianrod's hair adrift like veils of algae across her mouth and cheek. There was nothing here she could not sense remotely. But the emotional weight of her decision had brought Caitlin here, as if to stand face to face with Arianrod. Some things you did in person because that was the way they were done. She needed to be close to make this choice. She needed to be able to reach out and lay the weight of her own heavy gauntlet against the manual override, if that was what she chose. She needed to be able to tell herself it was not vengeance that brought her here, but simple math. Arianrod's life used resources better reserved for others whose simple existence was not a threat. Caitlin took a breath of dusty-smelling, filtered air and thought about the irrevocability of her decision. It still didn't seem slight, even when balanced against the limited and irretrievable resources of her world. But everything was in her head. Atmospheric pressure and composition, wildly fluctuating heat in the habitats where the air wasn't simply frozen in plate-fragile shingles to the bulkheads, and the simple fact that Arianrod had tried to kill Caitlin's daughter. The world, the corners of it she could reach, stretched into her, gave up its information as the ghosts of sensations laid over her own. She wore it as an armature, over the mind-wiped armor. This was new and alien, this sense of her world present and imminent. Implied. She felt the gaps in the awareness as well, the broken and simply missing bits of the world, the ones with which all contact had been severed. They ached strangely, a numb kind of pins and needles emptiness that unsettled her to the core. So this was what it meant to be the chief engineer of a restored world, restored and crippled in the same blow, and Caitlin was old enough to find the irony bitterly amusing. The price in lives, in materials, in the integrity of the world had been too high, but it had been paid nonetheless, and now the debt must be serviced. Inside this pod slept a woman Caitlin had known for centuries, beside whom Caitlin had worked, whose child Caitlin had adopted as her own before that child gave up her life and her existence to stop Arianrod's plan. Merely by living, the woman in this pod consumed resources better put to use by those who had not betrayed Engine, and Caitlin and Samael and the very iron world that cupped them in its warm embrace, holding the enemy at bay. A woman whose body contained carbon and salt and organic compounds. She could be useful, repurposed as part of the air they breathed, the walls that kept them. Caitlin didn't need her hands to change the tank settings any more than she needed her eyes to see inside, but there was a certain dignity imparted by being physically present when she made this choice, an acknowledgement that it was momentous. And that, she hoped, was the difference between herself and her father. She rested her fingertips on the override. Chief Engineer? A familiar voice, but full of unfamiliar inflections, she jerked her hand to her side, torn muscle and stressed bone protesting, and turned on the balls of her feet. Beneath her opened visor, she looked out at the dark curls and arched brows that had once belonged to her half-brother. But Oliver Kahn was dead, and the person who wore his resurrected body now was someone from the moving times. She had never known Oliver. He was a Kahn, but he was a young Kahn, and Caitlin had been dead to her family for 3 or 4 times his lifespan. Still, he bore the family stamp. So, for a moment, Caitlin wondered why it was that all her siblings had chosen to look so like Alistair, their father, the dead Commodore. Whatever evils Ariane Rod and her daughter Ariane had accomplished, they had at least succeeded in destroying Alistair. The act might have bought them more sympathy from Caitlin if they had not tortured, crippled, and nearly killed Percival to do so. Chief Engineer, the young man who had been Oliver Kahn said again. Caitlin realized she had been staring. Yes? The resurrectee swallowed, eyes wide. Did she awe him? Was it cruel of her to find it funny if she did? Prince Benedict sent me with a message. He asks that you return to Central Engineering as soon as possible. Not as soon as is convenient, which is what Benedict would say if it truly were not urgent. He would send a messenger rather than calling her directly. Coward. What is your name? Caitlin said. Jasutian, he answered with a stammer. Damien Jasutian. I was an astrogator. Jasutian, she echoed, to fix the sound of it in her symbiont's memory. It's good you brought the message in person. He nodded. She pressed the override shutdown on Ariane Rod's tank. It depressed with a solid click. With her code key, she locked it out. Watch this, she said, as status lights began to blink from green and yellow to orange and red. When the tank is quiescent, give it 30 minutes and mark the contents for recycling. Do you understand? 30 minutes after shutdown, mark the contents, he repeated. Report to me when it's done. She smiled and patted his shoulder before she turned away. Though she left, still she carried the feed in her head. Ariane Rod drifting in her acceleration tank, eyes closed, skin pale and blue-gray. One by one, the lights cycled to red. The short return walk through battered corridors disheartened her. Shredded vegetation browned underfoot and hung ragged from rent bulkheads. Insects scurried in advance of her steps, racing from leaf to leaf, seeking cover. A darter flashed from the tangled vines on the wall to snatch up a wriggling centipede, then vanished again in a flash of indigo feathers. So some of the world's ecosystem had survived the transition, even unprotected. A little encouragement among the ruins. And there were materials for cloning. The world could be rejuvenated. The work was daunting, but it could be done. When she emerged into the great heaven of engine, she tried to focus her gaze directly forward. The city surrounded her, a great hollow sphere, with every surface knobbled with shattered structures. Debris drifted freely, and the air was thin and cold. Gravity was a lower priority than oxygen, so even where she floated, the atmosphere was sufficient to sustain exalted life. The unsecured debris was a threat, but she had no resources now that could be detailed to secure it. Caitlin did not regret the decision to exalt every living thing in the world. Nothing mean would have survived the acceleration, or the radiation of the supernova that had boosted the world back into flight. Infecting them with symbionts, even new and fragile symbionts that must struggle to become established even as they struggled with the damaged bodies of their hosts, was preferable to watching them all die. It had been a fighting chance. Failed gravity made it easier to reach Central Engineering. Caitlin spread her hands, sealed her helm, and used the attitude jets to nudge herself gently across the cavernous space, fending off debris with a raised and armored hand. Catch bars on the far side eased her touchdown. She swung her feet through a hatch that opened to her nonverbal command. When the gravity on the far side caught her, she twisted to drop into a crouch. Central engineering was a shambles of broken panels and shattered furniture. In the midst of it stood Benedict Kahn alone, wearing his armor against the potential of a hull breach. He bent over the main navigation tank, hands gliding with assembly robot grace as he effected repairs. He was assisted by a quiet-eyed toolkit that looked something like a cat and something like a lemur with enormously elongated forelimbs. Its ringed tail twitched. Its focus was total. Spotted gold-black fur rippled over its flanks as it reached deep into the guts of the tank. Once it, too, had had a name and a personality, it had been a small, independent life. Now it was but a thing, obedient, versatile, and consumed in the greater awareness of the world's new angel. Caitlin unsealed her faceplate, thought of Rienne, and chose not to wince in front of Benedict. When she stood, pain shot up both legs to the hip, but she would not permit that to show in her face either. She pushed to her feet on fragile bone, half-healed, the persistence of her symbiont maintaining its integrity. If she kept dealing it setbacks, it would only take that much longer to repair her. She needed to discipline herself, not to push through the pain, but to sit still for it. As still as Arianrod. Still drifting and dying in her tank. It would be better this way. It would be better still if Tristan thought she had died in the acceleration when he came to find out. "I have contact with Tristan on the bridge," Benedict said, in as much of a greeting as she was likely to get. She stepped forward, armor clicking on the deck, the bones of her left foot crunching with every stride. She paused at her brother's elbow, craning her neck back to examine his profile. Dull black hair framed a long, square face, making it seem longer. His eyes didn't flicker from the display tank. If he had not spoken, if he were not Benedict and Exalt, and more aware than any man she knew, she would only have known that he recognized her presence because he had spoken. "Percival?" she asked. His lips compressed, grieving. "She's young," Caitlin said. "She'll do her duty as it needs doing." Still, he would not turn and look at her, though she knew his symbiont showed him everything that crossed her face. "I know she will," he said, and then reluctantly, "one of us could go to her." The pang under Caitlin's breastbone took her breath away. He might not look at her, but she could study him. Her fingers twitched, and she wasn't sure if the suppressed desire was to tug his sleeve or strike him. "Tristan is with her. He'll suffice." "He's not." Now he looked, head snapping around as if he had been resisting the motion with all his might and his strength had finally failed him. "No," she said. "You're her father, but you are here. And these are lifeboat rules. Do the work under your hand, Ben." Another man, especially another Kahn, would have said something cruel in reply. But Benedict only pressed his mouth thin and, without dropping his gaze, nodded once. She understood. It was the decision he had already accepted as inevitable and steeled himself for. But he had wished for her to make it, as he had over time made similar unpleasant choices for her, when they had still been a team. Caitlin also would not look down. She was still considering what to say next, whether to disengage from the conversation or to press him to the next level of honesty, when her half-attended feed from Arianrod's pod forced itself to the center of her attention, by failing like a snapped thread. Chapter 3. The Strength of Any Soul. From New Evolutionist Bible, Genesis chapter 13, Verse 16. I will make your offspring as unto the dust of the cosmos, so that if anyone could count the dust, then your offspring could be counted. Caitlin's eyes went wide. Benedict began moving. Even as she turned for the door, her armor rattling, he placed a hand on the console between them and vaulted it. His feet struck the deck where hers had been only an instant before, the old instincts of teamwork unaffected. Caitlin crouched. The armor assisted her leap, but Benedict heard her grunt of pain. The sympathetic twinge lay beyond the ice, so he observed it rather than feeling it, for which he was grateful. Caitlin gripped the edge of the broken hatchway and swung herself through. Benedict followed. His legs were healing, and he was much taller than Caitlin. With the support of his armor, he leaped, caught the lip of the hatch, and arced into microgravity on the heels of the chief engineer. She was already sailing across the cluttered heaven. Benedict kicked off, gliding in pursuit, hesitant to use his attitude jets for a boost until necessary. He reached the far wall a few meters behind her, copying her elegant swing into the corridor. The thump of her boots against the decking rang sharply. On foot, he could catch her. He pulled up abreast and between breaths panted, "Why are we running?" "I lost the feed from Arianrod's tank." Her words were crisp between controlled breaths. A little sound greeted each stride, too small to be called a grunt. A sound of pain. He winced silently, gritting his own teeth as if he could help her bear it. But she didn't need his help, and she was right. He reached into the network, feeling for the location of Arianrod's coffin, and found only empty space. He didn't have a chief engineer's connection with the world, but he could pull up a remote. He asked between controlled breaths, "Did the moat fail?" "No, it's the whole sector. What happened?" A shake of her head inside the helm sent curls escaping around the open faceplate. "I killed her," she said. "I overrode life support on the tank." Her stride lengthened, but he paced her easily. He could condemn her decision, confront her on it, suspect that it was based in the lust for revenge she accused him of. But that would be pointless and unfair and unlike Caitlin. No one could cling to a grudge like Caitlin Khan. But that did not abrogate her knighthood, and Benedict had never questioned her integrity. It was that integrity that had made her so outraged with his choices, with what she saw as selling out. She had forgiven him his role as their sister's killer, perhaps because he had performed the task at Kinrick's request. But the liaison and alliance with Arianrod, that she found unconscionable, though he had thought he had his reasons at the time. He had to admit that experience seemed to be bearing her opinions out. And he understood the root of her ethics. As far as he knew, in all her life, the only person Caitlin Khan had ever betrayed was their father. If you could be said to have betrayed someone who never deserved loyalty or duty in the first place, whatever the family betrayals, they had started with Alistair Khan. "Conserving resources," he said. She glanced sideways at him, eyebrows rising. Did she think he'd changed so drastically, or did she think she'd never known him? "You should have stayed to see it through," he qualified. "Never leave the helpless victim to expire in a death trap. Make sure." "Somebody," she answered as they came up to the chamber housing the acceleration pods, "sent me a message, and I left a guard. The resurrected you sent me." Her sideways glance said, "If you considered him trustworthy enough to bear your message, I considered him trustworthy enough to stand over a deathbed." She slowed. One arm canted out from the elbow to indicate a stop, then reached to her hip and unclipped her sidearm. She sighted along it before raising the weapon to high ready. Benedict echoed her gesture. He swung across the door and flattened himself against the bulkhead on the opposite side. Whatever difficulties the last 15 years had brought to their relationship, in this they were still machined smooth. Caitlin spun into the chamber, and Benedict covered her. He entered the room low with a quick snap to the side, disguising his silhouette against the wall. There was too much cover in here, too much visual and auditory clutter. The cables, the pods, the sound and smell of dripping fluid and torn flesh from the ruptured ones. Benedict widened his awareness, tuned his senses to, perhaps, the scuff of a bare foot on decking. The armor covered his skin, but it was richly endowed with sensors. He might sense the displacement of air. If Ariane Rod were still here, she was still naked. He had sealed her into the tank after her capture himself, and he had not left her gear in the netting. He might be able to smell warm, wet skin. It was no mysterious power, but rather a developed awareness to everything his own senses, the symbiont, and the armor could tell him. There was the fine edge of training, which was about developing trustworthy perceptions, learning to rely on them, and acting on them without thought or hesitation. The body knows the knife is coming as surely as a fly senses a falling blow and drops into flight to elude it. For now, Benedict's body told him there was no knife. But though he trusted it, he also believed in caution. Right-handed, he tapped the ceramic on his thigh. Caitlin glanced at him. He sealed his faceplate and she mimicked him. Benedict gestured left. She nodded and went, slipping between pods, using their bulk to break her silhouette and disguise the motion. Benedict followed on a staggered angle, inching along the rows as silently as possible in his clicking ceramic suit. Together they moved toward Ariane Rod's tank, keeping as much cover between them and it as possible. At 30 meters, Caitlin drew up, beckoning him closer. She caught his eye through twinned faceplates. Neither of them needed to ask if the other was ready. The count was all internal. She stepped out. He waited at the ready for her signal. "Wounded," she said, and he snapped around the corner to cover her as she moved forward. The resurrected he'd sent with the message lay on the floor, an azure puddle cradling his head. He'd sustained a savage blow. From here, Benedict could not see if there were other wounds. Anything the resurrected might have sustained would be unlikely to kill an exalt, since Benedict could tell there had not been any dismembering injuries. "He's alive," Caitlin dropped a knee beside him. Benedict kept her in his peripheral vision, but his job now was not to watch her, it was to watch for anyone who might threaten her. She glanced up. The tank's unsealed. "She's gone?" "Poof," Caitlin stood. "Shit." She turned, scanning the chamber as if she might see something. "Whoever came to collect her has a 3-minute start." But Benedict did not holster his weapon. The tank farm was large, and whoever had managed to shut off the moats on Ariane Rod's pod had also managed to move through the chamber unmonitored, which suggested a high level of access to the world's systems. He didn't need to say so. Caitlin would know this, and know also that the ability to do so suggested some instability in, or compromise of, the newly reconstructed angel. Ariane Rod and her rescuer could still be close. "If I leave now..." Benedict did not look at Caitlin, but she looked at him. She shook her head. "We have to warn Tristan, and you shouldn't go without supplies. Because 3 minutes was a long time, and the chase could stretch on, and whoever had come for Ariane Rod would be well provided." "There are stretchers in the locker," Benedict said. "Let's see if any more of the sleepers are ready to awaken, and then we'll call the bridge and evac the casualty." She stopped him. "Ben, I need to know I can trust you on this." If it were a melodrama, he would have unsealed his faceplate to look her in the eyes. But she was Caitlin Khan. He did not delude himself. If she chose, she could read his breathing, pulse rate, skin conductivity through the sensors built into his armor. In return, his symbiont could control those things. But it was, at its essence, an arms race. Because Ariane Rod was the mother of my youngest child, he hit the word was a little harder than the others. Rienne was dead, and he had barely known her. The knowing was his own fault. The death. He would hang that gladly on Ariane Rod, and on Ariane, her elder daughter, who was also his half-sister, and Caitlin's. Relations in the Khan family were nothing if not convoluted. Caitlin stared through a transparent mask. Benedict turned to search a nearby locker for a collapsible stretcher. He pulled the hand-sized oval from a rack that had once held 10, oriented it properly, and triggered it. The webbed hammock unfolded, supported at each corner by an artificial gravity neutralizer. He guided it to the floor beside the unconscious resurrected and moved to the man's head. Without being asked, Caitlin stepped to his feet and crouched down. Their eyes met and they lifted, stepped sideways, and shifted the man onto the stretcher. Caitlin triggered the neutralizers and the stretcher rose softly into the air. Benedict said, "We have a daughter too." Percival, now captain, who had been the one to finally manage the death of Ariane. Caitlin had already started to turn away. The sensors on her armor meant she would not need to look back to see him, but she did anyway. A lingering glance over her shoulder. It was a human moment. "I thought sentiment was beneath you." He touched the mobility control on the stretcher. The red-gold hemisphere flushed green, and it started forward. It would glide smoothly in whatever direction he indicated, as long as his hand remained on the control. "Our daughter is still alive," he said. If she had an answer, she kept it to herself. "Prince Tristan," the angel said, "there are complications." Tristan lifted his head from his arms. He must have slumped across the controls claimed by healing sleep. He could feel the dents in his cheek and forehead left by details on the panel, and a crease marked by a metal edge. The angel's avatar stood before the patched bulkhead. Its appearance had changed, now light refracted from silver hair, as if through the facets of a diamond. It folded hands before its breast, as if in supplication. "We can dispense with the prince stuff," Tristan said. He pressed hard on his eyes, rubbing grit from the corners. His beard prickled with unwashed sweat. "Where's the breach?" He regretted the idiom as soon as he uttered it. There was no telling how literal-minded a young artificial intelligence might be, but the angel seemed to take it in stride and without offense. It said, "Progress in restoring structural integrity is adequate. However, proprioceptive data is still erratic. I have deployed motes to collect electromagnetic spectrum telemetry about the integrity of the world, and if they are not destroyed by debris, we should have a schematic soon, at least." There was a pause, as if it waited for new data before it continued. "I have a message from the chief engineer, Prince Tristan. She wishes to warn you that Ariane Rod has escaped and asks that you return her call in haste. Also, an additional difficulty has presented itself. It appears the damage to the world and attendant loss of life has been extreme enough to trigger certain fail-safes." Did angels hesitate uncomfortably, or was that a concession to human frailty? A moment for him to organize his thoughts and prepare himself. Or perhaps a moment in which the angel could explore his response. Tristan didn't know. "How bad is it?" "Indeterminate," the angel said. "Bad is a value judgment. It is an evolving situation that may become problematic." "Specify." "The Jacob's Ladder's base program contains a number of fail-safe routines which are triggered in a case where the world sustains certain catastrophic damage. One such was the splintering of the Ur-Angel Israfel. After 5 centuries, Tristan still could not summon up a scrap of grief for the memory of Israfel. If the modern angels were autocratic, arrogant, and monomaniacal, they came by it honestly, and at least they had not also been omnipotent. Israfel had been all those things and utterly committed to the Builder's program. Tristan had no doubt at all that Israfel had been fully informed about the hundreds of thousands of frozen dead stored in the world's holes, raw material for whatever might be needed. When first the world was ruined, when the first Exalt were infected with their new symbiotic colonies, systems had been unable to maintain integrity in the original artificial intelligence of the Builder's design. In self-preservation, Israfel had shattered into smaller, more specialized entities. So Israfel had begotten Dust, the Angel of Memory, and Samael, the Angel of Mutagens and of Life Support, and Susibo, the Angel of Propulsion, and Azrafil, the Angel of Weapons Systems, and other lesser beasts as well. Predictably, defensive of their individuality, those angels had warred for which would control their reunited self. None of them had won, exactly, and all had been consumed. The nameless angel to whom Tristan now spoke was the result of that conflict, and it was the sacrifice of young Rienne, Percival's sister and beloved, that had given it an identity of its own. An identity that continued. The current issue is a protocol that is triggered when viable biologicals aboard fall below a critical volume, which is to say, in the wake of concussive and radiation damage sustained from the supernova, the world has begun repopulating its biosphere. Tristan pressed the palms of his hands flat to the panel. So what's out there? The angel folded its arms. That's an interesting question, and unfortunately, as my lack of proprioceptive data is progressive, I do not entirely know. Progressive? You're losing more sections? Yes. How is that possible? Causes as yet undetermined, the angel said. The cause may be cascading colony failures, or, and possibly more problematic, it is possible that this reset, if I may use the term, came complete with its own guardian angel. Israfel might be back, Tristan clarified. Back, the angel agreed, and ready to institute the Builder's plan. Tristan's voice rang as clear in Caitlin's ear as if he murmured into it. We seem to have inherited a complex of additional problems. Thrill me, she said, watching Benedict, still armored but unhelmed, pack concentrated rations and bottled water into a carryall. She triggered broadcast mode. You're on speaker. Tristan said, the world is attempting to repopulate. There's no telling what might be coming out of the cloning tanks. The program is for maximum biological diversity to be restored in the aftermath of catastrophe, on the theory that competition is the manner in which a balanced ecosystem is likely to reestablish itself. Wasteful, she said. That's the Builders for you. Maximum carnage as a tenet of religious faith. The amplified voice seemed to be reaching the resurrected Jesutian. At least he stirred, one hand coming up to press the nano-bandaged scalp wound, though his eyes stayed shut. Caitlin wished he'd hurry up and heal. The memory set that inhabited him, the skills of a moving times astrogator for which Benedict had reawakened him, would be extraordinarily useful in the near future. Wasteful, Caitlin said. She knew how much external management was necessary to keep most heavens functional. Benedict sealed his carryall with a touch. He clipped it to the shoulder of his armor and snapped his fingers for the toolkit. It had been grooming the claws of one hind foot in the corner. Enormous, lambent eyes, half-closed in pleasure, fluffy tail, flipped over the opposite toes. At his summons, it scampered squirrel-light across the rubble of ruined equipment, leaped to his outreached gauntlet, and swarmed up his arm to the shoulder where it curled itself under the edge of his hair. It peeked between strands, blinking. Caitlin could not believe anyone had ever gone out of their way to design anything quite so offensively cute. Benedict said, "The builders believed in competition." "Just to complete your morning," Tristan added, "the angel informs me that it has lost contact with certain areas of the world. It believes that it's possible the original Israfel has respawned an intact instance." Benedict splayed his fingers inside their gauntlets. Caitlin watched furtively. She had been right to create distance between them. It was too hard to stay angry with him when he was close and in pain. But she didn't dare let go of that anger. Looking at him now, she nursed her outrage, fed it scraps of bitter memory, and still, she felt it gutter. No memory of betrayal could stand up to the presence of the man. He said, "But the renewed world angel is Israfel." "It is an evolved Israfel," Caitlin corrected. "Pieces were lost in the shipwrecked time. Pieces evolved. Pardon me, angel, for speaking of you as if you were not here." "Fear not," the angel said. "I take no offense." "New pieces were added," Tristan said, when neither she nor Benedict could bring themselves to say it. "The problem is that the angel is not the only thing that's evolved. We have too. And the original Israfel would have the builder's unmodified plan at heart." Tristan's tone carried a world of implications as to what he thought of the builders, their plan, and their general godlike disregard for the health.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.